My name is Laila Shabir. I grew up in the Middle East in a Pakistani family where being a girl meant a completely different thing than in the West. The predominant emotion that women feel in my culture is fear. Fear of your reputation getting ruined. Fear of emotional assault, physical assault. And if a woman steps out, other women will point fingers at her and make her step back. When we got our first computer, I started opening it up and doing all these different things with it. I think I wrote my first program when I was like 11. So when I first applied to MIT, there's a lot of pushback. My dad took that very seriously, so he literally said, "It sounds so sexist now, but he was telling me to live fearlessly." And so I moved here in 2005. After that, I think my life got a lot easier. It was interesting watching these American girls because they're getting the same messages that I got as a girl growing up in the East, except the messages here are more subliminal. Games are definitely a part of it. They don't get Xboxes for Christmas. They get Barbies or something else, and their brothers get the Xboxes, even though they have the same expressed interest. So in a way, they don't have access. Thank you all for being here, and welcome to the second annual Girls Make Games Summer Camp. I just want to encourage you to think big and think about, I guess, the games that you play that you love and why you love them and what kind of games you'd want to make.
There are just as many girls out there who like video games, who like computer science. It's just that lots of people say that they can't do it.
When girls come in and see other girls that are just as nerdy, they feel revalidated in who they are. So the idea behind Girls Make Games was to give these girls a home.
Okay.
We give the girls 3 weeks to make their own game.
It's mostly your imagination, how you approach game design, and does the world need this game?
A lot of girls sign up for our camp and drop out just before camp starts. Their parents send us emails saying, "My daughter got the jitters tonight. She's not coming tomorrow." They're so sure that they're gonna be bad at it, because it feels like something that girls don't do.
Girls can just interact without having other people like boys. Sometimes they kind of think differently.
At school, if there's anything, any project that has to do with a PowerPoint or electronics, all the boys would take control over.
We do hold workshops at our co-ed. And we had a little girl who asked a question about, let's say, why is the bunny white? And a little boy in the back just went, "Why is the bunny white?" And his posse of friends just started cackling with him, and the girl just kind of shrunk into her own shell. And she never spoke after that.
You already added the animations, right? The walking animations?
Yeah.
Yeah, so we'll learn how to add those now.
It's impossible for a lot of people to think that something as fun as playing video games can be educational at all. What could it teach you?
So these are our milestones for what we need to get done.
You work with a team, so it's teaching them negotiations, teaching them grit, perseverance. And then, of course, there are no boundaries to what you can make because this is an imaginary world, and that's the part where the girls just go.
The salon is one of the levels. While, someone's washing your hair in the salon, you would, put down your iPhone, so I was, drawing iPhones.
We're making this game called Sprinkles, about a cupcake who lost its sprinkles.
Games have stories, characters, a lot of things that would appeal to girls.
This is the library where she can find some clues and reports.
They want to make games where the protagonist is a really good person.
So the story we kind of wanted to tell was a person overcoming their inner demons she's poor, she's also a lesbian, maybe she's getting bullied, and then someone walks by, like, and, you know, stands up for her.
Yeah.
I started out making games to help people learn, and now we're helping people learn other things, like gaining confidence or just being better at whatever you're doing through game making.
Games are important. They bring people together and they make you feel like competition against yourself or others and to do something they all enjoy. So I think they're very important.
Games are a way of influencing youth. And the more positive images that you can send them, the better citizens they'll be as they grow up. And I think girls take that responsibility very seriously. And that's why it's so important for girls to make more games so that more girls can enjoy games that are relevant to them and have good messages for them.
There are a lot of women who have cool ideas for games, but they think like, oh, that's not a good job for me because I'm a woman. And so I think if they decided that I can do this, then they would like go into the gaming industry and make a lot more games.
Thank you so much all for being here. I can't believe it's been 3 weeks. We have six teams and they're all very passionate about the games that they're making. So let's hear it from them.
The story of Sonia, who is a young Russian girl. And what happens is Sonia wakes up in this room, a dark room, with no memory of her past or anything about herself.
If you actually touch the guards, then you die.
In the process, I got a glimpse of the daunting amount of artwork that game artists have to do.
And the player with the ants would try and like get the cupcake, and the cupcake would try to avoid them.
When she opens the book, it transports her to the Jurassic Age, scattering all the pages throughout all 11 levels. What she has to collect in order to beat the game.
So that passion, that just makes me really happy, and I hope that they take it past camp. And I'm sure a lot of you have the same question where it's like, this is great, but where do we go after this, you know?
When the girls start entering the industry and you start seeing impact in 5, 10, 15 years when girls come up and say, if it wasn't for Girls Make Games, I wouldn't be here at Xbox. If it wasn't for Girls Make Games, I wouldn't be publishing my first title. And I expect that to happen. That'll be the moment that I'll say, yes, that's why we did this.
Hi everyone, thank you so much for being here today. I'm gonna be honest, this is a little weird doing a video recording. I've never done this before. I think in person it's just a lot easier when you're kind of faced with the crowd and you can see how your bad jokes are going over or if you're putting people to sleep. So I'm hoping that with my really exaggerated hand gestures I can kind of keep all of your attention and also keep myself active so I also don't put myself to sleep. Well, I wanted to kick off this talk with the little documentary that you saw on Girls Make Games and also how it talked about you know, where I grew up and my childhood and what kind of experiences that might have had. Those are my formative years, and like anyone else, the experiences that I had and the things I did or the people I met shaped deeply who I ended up becoming today. I think it's important to take lessons, you know, looking back into where you came from, to your roots, which is, you know, when Bram reached out to me and said that the theme of the festival was roots, and immediately that tells me childhood. So I want to talk a little bit about my roots and the lessons that I learned through those experiences in my roots. I'm not really a big advice-giving type of person. So the format of this talk is going to be more about my stories, and I'm going to tell you like a bunch of stories, and I hope some of them are interesting to you, and I hope some of them resonate with you. And I'll also talk about the lessons that I learned through those stories and anecdotes. Now, a major part of my childhood growing up was spent alone. You could find me in the backyard digging up holes so that worms would have a warm place to sleep at night. Or you could find me painting my chickens' toenails. I really wish we had home videos so I could show you. But while I was doing all of these things, I was spending a lot of time on my own. And I started thinking about how kids these days don't really do that. I started also thinking about how the word alone scares people. So obviously while I was doing my research, I went to my favorite teacher, which is Dr. Google, and I looked up the word alone in Google Images. This is what I found. Alone, 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 very, very alone, sad-looking people. The term that actually stands out more to me right now is the word lonely. They all look pretty lonely. So I wanted to see what it looks like, what the word lonely looks like on Google Images. And these are the search results for lonely. Man, those are some really sad images. And finally, I went to look deep down inside my husband, and this is what I found. This is what he thinks the word alone looks like. And I'm sure a lot of you can kind of relate to, you know, being alone means being lonely and sad and dejected and not being able to scare up a Valentine. But to me, all these years, my source of confidence and reflection has come from a place of solitude. And that's where I wanted to draw the big, huge contrast. Alone is not the same as lonely. Alone is actually solitude. When you're alone and you're actively alone and you choose to spend that time with yourself, you're engaging in solitude. And those two things, you know, alone and lonely, are completely different. Lonely comes from a lack of connectedness, that the lack of something that completes you, whether it's people or, you know, your significant other, feeling fulfilled in the job or, you know, life that you have. But alone is an act that you can pursue to improve yourself. So I wanted to touch a little bit about how, you know, some of the girls that we see at camp and some of the kids that we're looking at these days, I'll draw a lot of analogies to how kids are, because again, a lot of my work, which is educational games and summer camps, deals with children, and we see them all the time. The average 10-year-old today has a cell phone. Now, can you imagine what something like that would do to the psychology of a child? They're constantly on Snapchat. They're constantly getting notifications, whether it's phone calls or texts. They're very, very connected, but they're not connected with themselves. They're not spending enough time learning who they are. And if you're not connected to yourself, you can't connect with others. I mean, you can draw this analogy even in bigger into adults. You can look at yourselves. How much time on a day-to-day basis do you spend by yourself? Whether it's by accident or, you know, in your commute or walking in the rain, or whether it's, you know, actively seeking that alone time, sitting with a good book or with tea, looking out the window and kind of thinking about your day and the events that are about to unfold. You know, there's a whole subreddit called Shower Thoughts, and I find it really funny because shower is definitely a place where most people end up being alone. And it's no surprise that's where a lot of stuff that you thought was kind of junked up in your head comes to you, like, where did I place that notebook that I've been looking for forever? Oh, it just came to me in the shower. Imagine how much power that time that you spend with yourself could be if you actively engage your mind to be creative, to be powerful and expressive. You know, creativity is an interesting thing too. I'm sure the artists among you have experienced, you know, those certain moments where you're just really inspired and you kind of just need to jump right into it. And you don't care who's around you or what's going on. You're just really consumed by the activity and you're fully immersed in expressing yourself through your art. Those are the moments that being alone defined for me. So now what I actually do, as soon as I start feeling overwhelmed, and that happens quite often because, as you can imagine, running two different businesses and managing teams, parents and students and all that stuff, it can get pretty overwhelming. So I try not to pack my entire day with communication with just outsiders. I also carve away time, you know, the notion of me time. I actually carve that away so I have time to spend with myself and think about what's going on and how I've been doing. You know, how often do you ask yourself, how are you doing, Laila? So that's essentially the first step here. The second lesson that I wanted to talk about is pretty relevant today, and that is the power of standing alone. Now, you might have heard of, you know, what's going on right now in the U.S., and we're throwing around words like resist and persist. You can't resist and persist if you can't resist and persist alone. You can't stand up for someone if you can't stand up for yourself. And I'll talk about two big instances in my life that taught me this lesson. The first one, I was fairly young. I was just about to finish my first year in high school when I started looking at my curriculum. I was enrolled in a British school, so we were doing the Cambridge O-levels, which I think some of you might be familiar with because it's European. And the course is expected to take a span of 3 years. I looked over the curriculum and it looked like I could condense it somehow if I did some weekend studying or something. I could probably do it in 2 years. And there I was, sitting with the curriculum, super psyched, but with myself, saying, oh my gosh, I think I figured it out. I'm going to condense this curriculum into 2 years, and then I'm going to do it, and then I'm going to teach other people. It doesn't need to take 3 years, you know, that's too long. And here I am, really happy and excited with myself. So I take up this proposal and march right up to my school principal to get permission to kind of use this newfound method on myself so I could take the tests with the older kids. And obviously, as expected, she was very, very not excited about the prospect. she took one hard look at me and said, no, these are the rules, Layla, and if you cannot follow the rules, you don't need to be here. And those, I mean, are not exactly her words, but paraphrasing, that's what I walked away with. So when I went home, I had a very long think and I had a conversation with my father about it. And I have to bring my dad into this because he's one of those guys who looks at authority and wants to question the way things have been done. He's not afraid to ask questions. He's not afraid to say, is this really the best way to do this? So when I presented my case, he immediately went, well, if you can do it in 2 years, wouldn't that save us money, time, and all of this pain? And that's exactly what I was going for. So, you know, I dropped out of school and ended up doing the test in 2 years. I, you know, got straight A's. I got this distinction and all that stuff. And now, funny thing, that school teaches the British O-levels in 2 years instead of three. So that was an example of kind of going against the current and then accidentally creating a cultural shift. The second example I'm going to give you is less from my childhood. It's actually more recent. It's from my first job out of college that ended up in a cultural shift in that workplace was, I just started at this bank and I was super excited, you know, to wake up at 5 a.m. so I could get to work at 6 and work all day and get done at like 7 or 8 p.m. whenever my boss cut it out, which is the thing people do, by the way. It's like for showing face, you kind of have to be at work because your boss is there. Don't leave before your boss, arrive before your boss, all of those things. Now, I know, you're thinking you were at work from 6 a.m. to 8 p.m. This is why America sucks, right? Well, I'm not going to defend the work hours. I know Europeans have a completely different standard of what it means to have a long work day, but that was the reality we were living in. 14 hours a day as a 21, 22-year-old right out of college, working like dogs day and night. And we just accepted it because that's how things have always been done. That's what my boss went through, that's what my boss's boss went through, you know, that's just how things are done. And here comes someone, me, who was very excited about it for the first couple of weeks, and, you know, I started getting extremely exhausted and burnt out, as you can imagine. And I wasn't alone. I mean, my peers were going through the exact same thing. The only difference was, I just decided to not take it anymore. For the most part, here's what happened. We would walk in at 6 a.m. The New York Stock Exchange opened at 9 a.m., which is when our clients really needed us when there was day trading happening. And it closed at 4 p.m. So you're done for the day, maybe stay 1 hour, kind of clean up the books and everything. But the whole notion of coming in 3 hours before you're really needed and staying several hours after your work is done, just so you can say, I spent 14 hours at work, did not make sense to me. I wasn't going to score brownie points by spending the most time at work. If I really wanted to contribute, and the way I actually did contribute, was by making my client happy. And my client was happy. My work was done. I finished it up in 8 to 5 and kind of just decided one day to show up at 8 and leave at 5. And I started just doing that day in and day out. My boss was not happy. I got called to his office, and he said, "You know, what's going on? Are you sick? Should we be worrying about you? Do you need to see a therapist? Because you're acting crazy. How dare you come in so late?" And my response to him really was, "I don't see why I need to be here when all of my work is done. I don't see why I need to be here so early in the morning when I don't have work." And that was it. It's pretty plain and simple, as I really expected to get fired after that conversation, but I didn't. I have no idea why. And slowly but surely, more and more people started taking cue from me. So I had peers who initially were very afraid, but every other day would kind of follow my hours. And over time, more and more of us, up until the point that all of our analyst class was doing the same thing. Well, they're not going to fire all of us, right? So it's an even stronger position to be in. And it's been a few years that I've been out of work, out of that job, and I'm being told that those are the hours that people work now. That was a cultural shift that started with someone standing alone, literally standing up, grabbing her things and going home alone. So I guess the lesson that I'm trying to share here is when you question norms, when you question culture, when you create something that has a power to shift culture and change the way people have been doing things, believing that that was the best way to do things, or that was just the way to do things, you will face a lot of pushback. You'll get people who will plain old ridicule you, harass you, face you with all kinds of rejection. I'm facing it today. I mean, not so much with Girls Make Games. We're really fortunate that we've had so much support with the work we're doing. But the other aspect of my job, which is making educational games, it's been tough. I mean, as much as people love video games, the notion of making education accessible through play and through entertainment is still something that's met with skepticism. You still hear people saying, "I don't know, a lot of people tried, XYZ company tried, they burned $10 million and the CEO was fired and they never got anywhere." So this is the reality that I live in, and I still passionately and completely 100% believe that you can make learning accessible through play. And I urge you to do the same in your lives. I mean, I'm sure whatever it is that you're doing, whatever it is that you're going through on a day-to-day basis, there are parts of it where people just look at you and say, are you sure you want to do that? That doesn't seem right. But if in your heart you feel like that's the best way to do what you're doing, and in your heart if you feel like what you're doing is the right thing, go for it. Personally, I have two major rules that I like to run my rebellion, if you will. I run a rebellion by. And those two rules are, stand alone as long as, one, you're not hurting anybody, and two, you're not rebelling for the sake of rebelling. These are both really important to me, because in pretty much every example, including the ones that I just gave, if I don't test my theory with, am I hurting someone by taking this stance, then it's already a no-no. In my bank's case, I was definitely not hurting my job or my boss or my bank. They were getting all the work done. The client was happy. In the case of my school, where I would have improved the curriculum and improved student life quality and the return on everyone's investment, which is tuition, it wasn't hurting anybody. And in both instances, and many, many others, I wasn't rebelling for the sake of rebelling. Now, what does it mean to rebel for the sake of rebelling? Well, you'll see a lot of this on social media. I urge you to just open up Twitter, and I'm sure you'll find all kinds of tweets back and forth, really heated up conversations, name-calling and finger-pointing, and, you know, for the most part, a lot of things that we see on social media are rebellious acts for the sake of rebellion. It's hard not to give in to this. I mean, with the kind of attention you can get based on just one angry Facebook post or one angry tweet, it's hard not to give in to that desire. I mean, we all want attention. We all want validation. That said, these are just checks that can help you decide whether this is a time to, this is the right stance to take or not. And finally, the third thing that I wanted to talk about and the third lesson that I wanted to share is, you're not alone, even when you're alone. And what I mean by that really is, we've all had those moments of self-doubt. We've all had those days and weeks and, you know, alone times when we've wondered if we're smart enough, pretty enough, resourceful enough, good enough, worthy enough of love. It's Valentine's Day tomorrow, so a lot of people are going to be asking that question soon. And the people that actually taught me this lesson were my girls at Girls Make Games. You know, we have all these 10, 12, 13-year-old girls that come to camp, and they, for a lot of them, this is the first time that they're meeting other girls that are just like them, that have the same passions and quirks, and they read comic books and are really into anime and are not considered weird just because they do those things. Imagine being 12 and being the only person that you know that's like you, whether you're African American or disabled or a girl who's interested in a certain thing, and all you see around you or people that are not like you, it does make you question whether you belong. I know I experienced that growing up. It was brief, thankfully, but for some time in my life, and I think this was between the ages of about 10 or 11, when I really got into soccer, I have no idea how, but I was just really into street soccer, which is essentially playing soccer on the street. I chopped off my hair, and so I had like boy style hair. Now, I know that is really okay today for a girl to have that short hair, but remember, this is 90s, early 90s, United Arab Emirates, Pakistani girl, lower middle class family, and all that stuff that comes with it. So I'd wear a baseball hat and kind of just run outside and play with the boys. I called myself Ali, which is a boy's name. So I identified myself as a boy. And that act kind of led me to question if I ever was meant to be a girl. This is 10-year-old Laila. She's never been interested in playing tea time or dollhouse or fashion or shopping or makeup. Things that are traditionally expected of, you know, of girls. Again, this is completely different today. People are starting to talk about it. But this is 20 years ago. 20 years ago in the Middle East, in a small town, almost a village. That, if I want to say those few months were extremely confusing. I went through like all kinds of conversations with my friends, and I wanted to understand if I was supposed to be a boy growing up. I even asked my mom, "Mom, was I a boy when I was born and you changed me into a girl?" Well, the things that kids ask, right? So imagine my delight when I turned 18 and moved to the US and I met all these crazy people. And everyone was just as quirky and had just as an interesting story. And they made me feel like I belonged, which is exactly the way the girls at Girls Make Games feel. They feel like they belong. This is home. You're okay. You're not a weirdo. This is how you were supposed to be, and this is how you are, and that's the end of the story. No doubt, no questions, no concerns. So I'm going to leave you with just a couple of words. I know this is primarily an arts festival, so I know being like an artistic person who is, you know, sensitive to critique or can get a little emotional about the work that I'm doing or the things I'm saying. So if there are things in your life that make you feel, am I the only one? Or I wish I wasn't the only one. I just want you to know, you're not the only one. There's millions of us. There's millions like me. There's millions like you that are in the exact situation. There's millions of Muslims that can't travel, that are affected by the travel ban, that are affected by policies. There are millions of disabled people, millions of women being affected by policies being made by a president. You're not alone. We're all in this together. Thank you.